Good evening, everyone. First of all, I'll thank you all. Can you all hear me, please?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much for allowing me to be a part of this August faculty with a very enlightening evening I've had. We thoroughly enjoyed. Thanks a lot. Beautiful presentation. I'm going to be very briefly talking about how to evaluate a patient of diplopia. And diplopia is a very vast topic. So The questions that we need to ask and the things we need to look at when we see a patient of diplopia is the outline, brief outline of my talk today. What is diplopia? It is when you see more than one image of the object of regard, when more than one image is seen simultaneously. It may be physiological, it may be pathological. And now, what is physiological diplopia? A fundamental property of binocular vision can be easily elicited. And its presence in a subject is a very reassuring sign because it is an evidence of binocular cooperation. It still remains a very important tool in the treatment of concomitant strabismus. Now, it is quite amazing to actually be able to have two different retinal images produce one single vision. That is the, it is really a very important thing. Because it needs a lot of things to come together. We need a perfect alignment of visual axis. We need perfect retinal correspondence. We need perfect central fusional capability, perfect alignment of retinal receptors, perfect or near or perfect optics to allow only one image to be formed on the retina. So when any one of them goes astray, the patient starts we start seeing patients of diplopia. So when a patient comes to us complaining of diplopia, there are certain important questions that need to be answered while taking the history of the patient. The first question is, does the diplopia resolve when one eye is covered? That is, whether it is it monocular or binocular? Start with first question. Does the diplopia disappear on closing one eye? If it does, it's a binocular diplopia. If it doesn't, then it is a monocular diplopia. And mostly cases of monocular diplopia are the result of an optical aberration, which improves on a pin with using the pinhole. So cases, we have to look at, do a good anterior segment examination and look for irregular astigmatism due to corneal scars. Do a nice slit lamp examination of the cataract to look for anterior and posterior lenticular irregularity, tear film insufficiencies, dislodged pseudophakos and macular pathology. However, in some cases of monocular diplopia, even pinhole does not help. And these are the cases we have to look at the neurological possibilities like post-brain trauma patients and cerebrovascular accidents. Sometimes even patients who are undergoing an amblyopia treatment complain of monocular diplopia. Now, if the patient who comes to us diplopia gets resolved by covering a single eye, it means it's a binocular diplopia. And then we come to question two, that is the diplopia same in all positions of gaze, or does it vary with gaze direction? So when it's same in all positions of gaze, that means it's a concomitant deviation. It is characteristic of congenital or early onset strabismus, and typically it is not associated with diplopia. However, we do see patients, especially the more older people in the older decades of life, presenting with diplopia when there is a, basically it gets decompromised, a well-controlled exophoria or an esophoria decompensates because of waning accommodation. They can present to us with concomitant deviations. Another type of concomitant deviation leading to diplopia is divergence insufficiency, which manifests as an esodeviation, which is greater at distance than at near. It is usually a benign syndrome. However, we have to rule out a resolving sixth nerve cranial nerve palsy, sixth nerve palsy in one eye, or a highly symmetrical bilateral cranial nerve palsy, which may give rise to a picture like a divergence insufficiency. Now, if a patient has an incompetent deviation, most likely it's an acquired, and we have to find the cause of it. So we have to look for cranial nerve palsies, the third, fourth, and sixth nerve palsies, and also the neuromuscular junction abnormality causing diseases like myasthenia gravis. or a restrictive etiology like a trapped or a fibrotic extraocular muscle has to be ruled out if the patient is presenting with diplopia with an incomitant deviation. So we have to answer the questions number 3 and 4 in patients with these kinds of deviations. First, is it horizontal, vertical, or oblique? Because it will give us a clue to which extraocular muscles are involved in the causation of diplopia. And secondly, is it constant, intermittent, or variable? It's a clue to the etiology. If it's constant, it's a paretic or a restrictive squint. If it's intermittent or variable, then it might be a neuromuscular problem like a myasthenia gravis patient. So what happens in a binocular diplopia? The eyes lose their simultaneous alignment with the object of regard in one or more directions of gaze. However, very rarely, even in the absence of misalignment, if the patient complains of a binocular diplopia, we take a deep look at the retina of the patient, look for some retinal wrinkling or a drag fovea syndrome, where the patient may develop, manifest with symptoms of binocular diplopia. After taking a thorough history and finding clues to the questions that we had posed in the beginning of the talk, we go on to the physical examination. Look at the external examination, look for proptosis or ptosis, any swelling or redness around the eye. Do careful ocular movement testing, making sure that the patient has a correct head posture. Both ductions and versions have to be tested. A cover and cover test, alternate cover test has to be done in all positions of gaze. We have to measure the deviations using the prism bar cover test, fixing each eye to see if the primary and the secondary deviations are equal. And we also have to take measurements for near and far fixation. I will not be discussing each of these physical examination findings in detail because they've been very nicely elucidated by my previous speakers. I will be going on straight to diplopia charting, essential part of a diplopia patient's workup. Now, diplopia is tested using two principles. First, the diplopia principle, and second is the haploscopic principle. So, in the test based on the diplopia principle, we use a single test object. One has to find the subjective localization of a single object, and it has to be imaged with the fixating eye, and the other image is because forming on the extrafoveal retinal area, the patient that has to be imaged by the patient. Okay. So the false image will always be peripherally situated, and the separation of images is maximum in the field of action of the paralyzed muscle. So red glass test is one test, which is based on the diplopia principle, where we place the red glass in front of the right eye and see whether the patient is seeing one pink light or two red lights. And depending on the position of the two lights, we can find out the deviation, the direction, and the quantity. Mann-Hoff-Rock test is also very similar to the red test, the red glass test, but here we use stacks of cylinders arranged parallelly, and here we get a red line instead of the red spot. The double Mann-Hoff red test is used to measure cyclotorsion, and here two different Maddox lenses are placed in front of each eye. Now, the tests that are based on the haploscopic principle are the Hess chart and the Lees chart. In the Hess chart, the dissociation is made by the means of colors, but what it really requires is a cooperative patient who is not colorblind, and he has got good vision in both the eyes and a normal retinal correspondence. These are the steps of doing a Hess charting.
Time's up.
Just 1 minute more. Lees screen is a modification of the Hess chart itself. Here, instead of the red green stimuli, we use a mirror, central mirror dissociates the two eyes. And here, in both these cases, we use the same chart to draw the patient's responses. And here are a couple of examples that I've given of the Lees screen chart. The first one is an example of the lateral rectus palsy of the right eye. And here we see that the right chart has a smaller field than the left. It's an esotropia because the fixation points in the inner charts are shifted nasally. And the deviation is greater in the left chart, indicating that the left eye has a secondary deviation, so it is greater than the primary deviation. That is all I had the time to talk about. To summarize, it's important to do a very good clinical examination of a diplopia patient before going on to the other tests, imaging tests and all, because just the clinical examination gives us a lot of clues to the etiology and the possible management of the patient too.